for the USFL to go to the fall in 1986. One of the teams, the Tampa Bay Bandits, has agreed that at the end of this year, that it will withdraw from the league, and that John Bassett Enterprises will continue in its efforts to put together a separate multi-sport league that includes a spring football.
The suspense may be over, but the fight for survival is just beginning for the United States Football League. At center stage in the battle is a 5'9" quarterback named Doug Flutie. Though one of the smallest players in the USFL, Flutie is without question the most important player. New Jersey owner Donald Trump underscored his commitment to fall football when he signed Flutie to a multi-million dollar contract. Now the success of the USFL weighs heavily on the shoulders of America's most recent Heisman Trophy winner. Sharing the burden with Flutie is Herschel Walker, who stunned the football world 2 years ago when he signed with the Generals. At that time, Herschel's signing gave the fledgling league credibility and a major gate attraction. Today, 2 years later, the USFL has begun the most crucial stage of its history. Tonight, the league showcases its two leading performers when New Jersey hosts Orlando on ESPN.
Welcome to the Meadowlands in East Rutherford, New Jersey. A historic day in the United States Football League. Obviously, a feeling that fall is the place to be for football, and obviously feeling that they've got a pretty good case in their antitrust suit against the National Football League. The USFL will move to the fall of 1986. Hi, everybody. I'm Roger Twibel. You heard Commissioner Harry Usher say the vote was 12-2. Obviously, Tampa Bay Bandits and John Bassett, a dissenting vote. Also, Doug Spedding and the Denver Gold. Now, Spedding feeling that he wanted to keep his options open, possibly might be selling that team, that particular squad. The Denver Gold, even though with a very good record this year under Mouse Davis, is not drawn in the Mile High City this particular spring. Some good news coming out for the LA Express. That team will stay in existence. They are looking for an owner, but the league backing them 100%. Also, the Birmingham Stallions will stay in existence for the remainder of this season, and they will try to find new ownership for next year. Another note to Jerry Argovitz, the Houston Gamblers, saying that his team probably will be sold within the next week. Jerry will be on at halftime with Tom Meese, along with New Jersey Generals owner Donald Trump. So it will be the fall of 86. They will finish this year and they will take a year off about. They'll be back in July of 86 and they'll get things underway for fall football. Game at hand here tonight. The New Jersey Generals hosting the Orlando Renegades. Of course, working with me is Mike Hafter. And Mike, Orlando's got a big job ahead of them. Lost earlier this year, 28-10. How do you stop Herschel Walker and Doug Flutie? Can Lee Corso do them both?
Well, if I'm the head coach, I'm going to look at both players. I'm going to look at Flutie and I'm going to look at Herschel Walker and I'm going to say, Herschel Walker can beat me more easily than Flutie can. So I'm going to play four down linemen and I'm going to play four linebackers and I'm going to stop Herschel and I'm going to make Flutie throw the football.
Obviously, this team, New Jersey, did not see Reggie Collier in their game earlier this season.
They didn't, and he's going to be a surprise. He's a great athlete, Roger. He runs the ball well. He can throw the football and surprise a lot of people. And because they haven't seen him, and that New Jersey has some injuries on defense, could be very difficult for them to stop Reggie.
Reggie didn't run with it much last week, just four times. So for Orlando to do something big tonight, they've got to get the ball in the hands of Reggie Collier running with the football. The Generals, with a win tonight, will move into a tie for first place in the Eastern Conference. We'll be back with the opening kickoff from the Meadowlands right after this.
Roger Ruzek getting set to kick it off for the Generals as we're underway for the Meadowlands in East Rutherford, New Jersey. Back deep, number 85, and that is Jerry Parrish, the second leading kickoff returner in the United States Football League. Does a high hurdle across the 15 up to the 18-yard line. And the Orlando Renegades will put it in play, first and 10, as they mark it at the 19-yard line. Their quarterback is Reggie Collier, and he, of course, has come in to really give this team a good spark. In the backfield, Ricky Clatt, 35, Curtis Bledsoe, 23, Flowers, 84, Joey Walters, 17, the wide receivers, Nizelik, 89, the tight end, and then it's Joel Patton, 69, Jerry Durger, 70, Mark Fisher, 57, Tom Dornbrooks, 63, and Ed Moransky, 72. Second meeting of the year between these two teams, 28-10 in the first outing when Doug Flutie threw for four touchdown passes. Lone setback That is Bledsoe. He goes right up the gut. He gets about five up to the 24-yard line. As Will said defensively, the New Jersey Generals, Maurice Clemens in on the tackle. Up front, James Lockett, 96. Emmanuel Weaver, 69, and Jim Burns, 74. The linebackers are Weddington, 52, Clemens, 59, Bobby Leopold, 53, Jim Dumont, 56. Secondary, Holmes, 37, Donnell Daniel, 23, Gregory Johnson, 27, and Kerry Justin, 26, as it'll be second and six from the 24-yard line. That's 35, Ricky Klatt, and Jim Byrne met him right at the line of scrimmage, possibly a loss of a yard, and you will see the Orlando Renegades run to the left side behind Dornbrook 63 and Moransky 72, but Mike, after some defensive problems for New Jersey because they've got some key people out with injuries.
Yes, they do. When you lose linebackers and defensive backs, John Joyce for one, and Preston also, John Preston, and it really hurts you, and then you've got Woodlawn, the nose tackle. That's kind of the center of your defense, and without them, they're going to try to exploit it. They tried to run inside. Now they'll see if Collier in the shotgun can make some difference.
Third down and seven. Collier down the middle has got Bledsoe. Bledsoe across the 30 to the 32-yard line, and that'll be enough for a first down for the Orlando Renegades. Collier went back in the pocket. Sometimes you think of this man as simply a rollout quarterback. He dropped back nicely that time.
Yes, he did, and Lee Corso said today he is learning game by game to set there and throw the football and not to pull it down and try to do it all by himself, Roger.
Curtis Bledsoe with 24 receptions on the year and a touchdown. He is a talented running back out of San Diego State University. And when you play at San Diego State, you learn how to catch the football.
Yeah, you do, or you don't stay.
First and 10, ball at the 32-yard line. Klatt and Bledsoe, the running backs. This is Bledsoe. Excuse me, make it Ricky Klatt on a quick hitter up around the 34-yard line. Joyce, the linebacker, out with an injury. Preston, out with an injury. As you take a look at Lee Corso, his first year as head coach of the Orlando Renegades, first year as head coach in the professional ranks after many years collegiately at Northern Illinois, Indiana, Louisville.
And the guy right next to him signals in every play to Reggie Collier. We'll keep an eye on him, see if we can pick up the signals tonight.
Jackie Flowers splits the near side. Joey Walters, 17, to the far side on a second and six. Bledsoe is really stacked up right at the 35-yard line. Number 50, Kyle Borland. Third-year man from the University of Wisconsin made the initial hit.
Roger, what they're trying to do is take advantage of the fact that Woodlawn, Joyce, and Preston are all out of there, and they're running inside. The problem is the rest of the New Jersey defense knows they're going to do it, too, and they're going to say, hey, we don't miss them that much. We're going right after them.
Orlando was successful on their first third-down situation, and that was a 7-yard situation. Now they are faced once again third and seven. Out of the shotgun, Collier's got to call a timeout. Now offensively, on this particular formation, Mike, they took out the tight end, and Collier, missing some offensive personnel, decided for the timeout, and with 11:13 to go in the first quarter, will return to the Meadowlands. Roger Twybill, Mike Hafner back with you at the Meadowlands on a beautiful Monday evening for football. Crowd still filing in. Third down and seven now for the Orlando Renegades. Reggie Collier out of the shotgun formation. Going deep down the near side to Jackie Flowers. At the 22-yard line, Flowers cannot hold on to the football. Kerry Justin, the veteran from Oregon State, formerly with the Seattle Seahawks, back on the coverage. And Collier showed you good arm right there. The ball was right on the money, Mike.
Also took something off it too, Roger, which makes it look nice because he dropped it in and gave his receiver an opportunity to catch the football. Now watch the nice touch. Usually they say the guy with a big strong arm will throw it deep on a frozen rope, and all the DB has to do is turn around and knock it down. There he almost dropped it right in, and I think he had a shot to catch that one.
Cater to punt it from the 20-yard line. He has been a pleasant surprise for Orlando this year, averaging over 42 yards a kick. Danny Knight at the 20-yard line. And Knight hit at the 25. Gets just a couple of yards on the return there. Orlando on the tackle was Ed Jackson. No score from the Meadowlands in East Rutherford, New Jersey. And we'll be back right after this. In the Eastern Conference of the United States Football League, New Jersey, a victory tonight would move them to 2-7. And Orlando's a football team, Mike, which has played much better the past few weeks. Matter of fact, they've won two of their last three, losing to Jacksonville last week. As New Jersey will put it into play, Doug Flutie, the quarterback, Herschel Walker, Maurice Carthen, the running backs, Collins, 82, and Broughton, 85, the wide receivers. Carthen right up the middle, and he gets a couple of yards for you. Tied in is Sam Bowers, 89, Don Magg, 76, Wayne Harris, 64 on the right side of the offensive line. Kent Hull, 58, is the center. Vince Stroth, 66, and Doug Mackey, 73, the left tackle. As you take a look at Doug Flutie from Boston College, the miracle worker, if you will, and he's brought the Generals from behind a couple of times this year. Double tight end alignment right now as Jeff Speck, 81, in the game on a second down and 8. Walker. He's got the outside. Walker's got a blocker. Finally driven out at the 40-yard line. Victor Jackson was the only man between him and 6 points. And how many times have you seen Herschel Walker get to the outside? There was a flag down. I believe it was on Orlando. The left side of the defensive line appeared to jump. Indeed, it was 32 yards on the pickup for Herschel Walker. What's gotten into Herschel, Mike?
I'll tell you what's gotten into him. 2 years under his belt. He feels comfortable. He knows he's the man. Now watch how he just tiptoes. Now you'll see the after jets kick in. And Herschel Walker, when he turns on the speed, there better be somebody in the way or he's in the end zone. He is quick and strong. If he had a little more wiggle, he might be one of the great backs of all time.
But what he's got is not bad. First and 10. Ball's on the 40-yard line for the New Jersey Generals. Walker once again, and he has got the outside again. And 20, Victor Jackson literally had to give his body up to pull Herschel Walker down after a 9-yard pickup. And there is not a cornerback in football that cherishes that idea.
Now, when Herschel Walker goes to the outside, what you want to do is get your friend, the sidelines, in on the tackle. Because if you have to take him on like that too many times, you're going to find that your neck size goes from about 6 to about 3. And that is 2 carries for 41 yards. Thank you.
As soon as we get a chance, we'll set Orlando for you defensively. I don't know if they're set yet. Second and 1. Collins, the lone wideout. Pass intended for Clarence Collins. As you take a look at Doug Flutie, so far in the year has completed 48% of his passes, has thrown for over 1,400 yards, 10 touchdowns, 10 interceptions, and he's also run with the ball extremely well. 7.1 yard a carry, 5 TDs on the year, and I think the one thing that Walt Michaels has really tried to instill in Doug Flutie and this football team is playing within yourself and under control. He is not passing as much, but he's passing for quality rather than quantity.
He's also facing a defense tonight that he's never seen. 4 linebackers.
3rd and 1. Walker gets to the outside again. Walker's still on his feet. Walker carrying defensive men. As Herschel Walker is out at the 11-yard line, Jeff George went on a piggyback ride that time. He couldn't bring Herschel down.
Again, that great strength with the great speed, Roger. And if you're going to take him high, he's going to carry you. If you're going to take him low, then he's going to hurt you. So here, see, they get the high tackle on him, and he'll carry you for an extra 4 or 5 yards. If you take him low, you may not be in the game by the time you get to the end. 20 yards, and Walt's got a smile on his face.
There's a man who only missed 2 football games in his playing career. That's tough.
Yeah, it is. Linebackers aren't supposed to miss football games.
1st and 10 from the 11-yard line. And it's Herschel left. And Herschel is brought down right at the line of scrimmage. Moving in, Kevin Kellen, 94, the left defensive end. And let's set Orlando for you defensively. Kellen, 94, David Graham, 68. Ed McElhaney, 79, and Scott Hutchison, 66, the men up front. Linebackers are Kelvin Atkins, 55, Ron Freeman, 56, and keep an eye on him. He's very active. Ed Jackson is 50. The corners, Albert Gray, 22, Jeff George, 43, and Lupe Sanchez, 21, and Victor Jackson, 20, are the safeties. 2nd and 9. It counted at the 10-yard line. Herschel right. Herschel inside the 10, down to the 8-yard line. Kelvin Atkins, 55, the linebacker, is able to bring him down. Mike, when you get into a situation, and I know you're an offensive player, but when you want to tackle somebody the size of Herschel, it's either the shoelaces or the shoulder pads, isn't it?
Absolutely right. And in Herschel's case, as strong as he is upstairs, if you're giving away 20 pounds, I go for the shoelaces every time. And there aren't many defensive backs in the USFL with the size to take him upstairs. So you got to get down around the ankles, and you got to have help, too. Can't be just one guy.
Third down and 7 for the Generals. Broughton split to the near side. Collins at the top of your screen. Flutie, the sidearm pass to Speck. He makes the reception at the 4-yard line. Victor Jackson right there. And Doug Flutie just showed you some of his athletic ability. There was a man in his face as he looked like he was going to go on the naked bootleg, and he found Speck.
Roger, when you're that short, 5'9" and a half or whatever, everybody says, well, he can't throw the football in any league. Well, he's been 5'9 all of his life, folks, and he's learned how to get out of the way of big defensive linemen.
Well, the
so
crowd,
it's not really true.
The crowd wanted Walt Michaels to go for it. They won't. Ruzek will attempt the field goal. Counted as a 21-yarder so far in the year, 1 of 1 from 20 to 29 yards, 4 of 6 on the year for Roger Ruzek. Rick Partridge, the punter, is the holder. It's good. 21 yards in the field goal for Roger Ruzek, and the New Jersey Generals jump out to a 3-0 lead over the Orlando Renegades with 6:34 to go in the first quarter. Now, this should be a good game. Birmingham and Memphis live Friday, and you saw Memphis against Denver really get it all together for the first time this year.
That defense shut down the run and shoot, and you got to be good defenders to do that.
Ruzek to kick it off, 3-0 the lead, 74 yards, 9 plays in 4 minutes and 23 seconds. And this is a guy that returns a lot of kickoffs, Jerry Parrish. And he is a good one, taking a couple back for touchdowns. That's real close. Let's see if it got into the end zone or if it went out of bounds.
It looked like it hit in the end zone, Roger, and it'll bring it out to 20-yard line.
The Orlando Renegades on this year, well, it's been a tough road for them. Really an expansion team at best, still only 7 of the Washington Federals around. They lost to Tampa Bay, lost to New Jersey, lost to Birmingham, but then 3 games, Portland, Jacksonville, and Denver. They could have won any of those. Lost an overtime game to Jacksonville, then 1-2. They beat Memphis and they beat Arizona, and then got their clocks cleaned by Jacksonville.
You know what happens
last week?
You know what happens with a team like this, and I'll do it quickly, is that everybody takes them lightly. Then all of a sudden they win 2 or 3 in a row, and then they get serious about them, and that's why they turned it around then.
First and 10. Near side, and he's got his tight end, Echols. Look at the hit, Echols. At the 40-yard line, Echols just buried his shoulder, and Donnell Daniel caught the brunt of it. 19 yards in the pickup, Reggie Collier to backup tight end Don Echols.
Here's a pattern where they thought it was run on defense. They were playing strictly run. Tight end slips out. Linebacker misses the coverage, so he's wide open. Now, what's the price that Echols is going to make the guy pay? Excuse me, as he bumps him. If he could have stayed in bounds, he could have broken even for longer.
Collier, 2 of 3 for 29 yards. And it's a first down for the Renegades at the 40-yard line. Collier's got Nizelik, his other tight end, across midfield to the 48-yard line. Jerry Holmes, 37, one of the men on the coverage, and also Donnell Daniel. Daniel started in place of John Preston, who was the leading tackler in the secondary for the Generals, and also the leading interceptor. So between John Joyce, the linebacker, and Preston, you have got their two top tacklers on the football team, and they're out with injuries.
And they're trying to take advantage of it. Another thing Lee Corso told us is Reggie Collier can't do it all himself. But he is the trigger man. He's got to do it all himself to get the other people involved. And so far, they've done an outstanding job. They've thrown to the tight end. They've thrown to a wideout. They've run the ball fairly well, and Collier's done some running himself.
Another first down, first and 10 from the 47-yard line of the Generals. Collier, he's got a man downfield. Flowers at the 9-yard line. It's taken away. It's taken away by Gregory Johnson. And Johnson's run out at the 35, and Flowers is still down at the 9. Let's see if that was an interception. If it was, it was the 7th time this year Collier's been picked off.
Collier's got his wide receiver open, clean, down the middle, in the zone. And
And that was just a great interception by Johnson. Took it right out of his hands.
Flowers had it.
He had it right on his hands, Flowers, and Johnson picked his pocket. A great play coming across in safety.
Second interception of the year for Gregory Johnson, and New Jersey has it now. First and 10 from the 37-yard line. Walker right. Penalty markers down as Herschel gets to the 40-yard line. Ron Freeman, 56, the middle linebacker, with 60 tackles on the year.
Holding, 89 on the offense.
Sam Bowers, the tight end, called for holding, obviously trying to get downfield and make some room for Herschel. Here's a look at Sam Bowers from Fordham. They don't really, they play club football. And Bowers, an interesting guy. He takes nothing for granted. Last fall, he played semi-pro football, so he played year-round.
It's like the baseball players who go down and play in the Mexican League in the off-season. Oh, well, he's young. He can get away with it. I tell you, that's the way to stop Herschel, though. Get a holding call
that's
against
right.
you.
You don't
yards.
Help
That's right.
Broughton comes to the near side. Collins split to the top of your screen on a first and 20 from the 27-yard line. 3 seconds left to go on the 30-second clock, and Herschel goes nowhere. Herschel Walker went absolutely nowhere. David Graham, 68, a second-year man from Morehouse, quickly across the line of scrimmage to meet Walker.
That play was dead the minute Flutie had to turn around and say, Herschel, you're in the wrong spot, because Herschel had an idea what he was going to do from the setback position. Now when he gets back to the eye, it was too late. He already had the idea from the setback spot, and that play was dead the minute he had to move it.
Mike, we see a lot of shuffling defensively for Orlando.
Four linebackers, four defensive linemen. They get in a passing situation. Then they'll run the nickel in there to help out when Flutie has to throw the football.
Second down, 22 yards to go. Flutie's got his man. It's Collins at the 42-yard line. Clarence Collins, not enough for the first down, and it was that man from UCLA, Lupe Sanchez, that put the big hit on him.
Sanchez, fine safety. Played some cornerback at UCLA. Now watch Flutie here. Again, they've set the tempo of running the football with Herschel Walker. Linemen are taking a little less of their pass rush. Linebackers stretching out because they're playing run first, and you see that big wide opening in the middle. And Flutie will do that all night if they're playing Herschel to run.
Third down and five, and Flutie has got room. He's got the first down as he gets out of bounds at the 48-yard line. Doug Flutie, Ron Freeman was the man closest to him, and Flutie, who has completed two of three passes for 21 yards, got a good block from Herschel Walker that time.
It's nice to see Heisman Trophy winner blocking for Heisman Trophy winner.
You know, Flutie's not adverse to getting out and throwing the block either.
That's true. A little bit on the bootleg and a reverse every once in a while.
Well, there's a guy, Doug Flutie, who averages over 7 yards a carry, and he got just about seven that time. And it's a first down for the New Jersey Generals. 3:23 to go, first quarter, and it's Walker Wright. He's across midfield to the 48-yard line. 74, Joe Ehrman, the veteran, one of the players in there. Also, Ed McElhaney, 79. And those two will alternate.
Lots of pressure on the middle linebacker, Ron Freeman, number 56 for the Renegades. His responsibility is pretty much number 34 in red, and he gets in there and roots around a little bit, but he's not going to win the battle consistently unless he gets help from everybody else.
Freeman, over 60 tackles on the year, a couple of sacks and an interception, so he's very active at that middle linebacker spot.
He's a good football player, but
Maurice Carthen. And this guy runs real tough, too. You hear of talk about Herschel Walker, you hear about Doug Flutie constantly, but Carthen, 33, out of Arkansas State, has rushed for over 460 yards so far on the year. He's had a 55-yard touchdown run. Did he team up with Bill Johnson at Arkansas State?
Sure did.
And
how about that?
And he's not going to be here next year, right?
That's right. He's going on to the Giants, who also play here.
Oh, they play in the same stadium.
Play in the same stadium. I'll tell you, how many times have you seen the fullback at Nebraska rip one for a long because they're looking for the tailback? Happens here, too. Carthen, he got a lot of help from number 34 also just by being there.
Third and four, both wide receivers, Collins and Broughton, to the near side. Flutie with the option to run or pass, now decides to throw it, and might have been a smart play is the ball was thrown out of bounds or either a real bad pass. It's hard to tell sometimes with Doug.
Not a real bad pass. He saw everybody covered, and he tried to make it look like a bad pass, but he was throwing it away. And if you throw it out of bounds, they won't call a penalty on you for grounding.
So, that'll set up a punting situation. And coming in is Rick Partridge, guy who's been around, played for 8 different teams professionally, not quite as many as Mike Hafner.
Oh, one more.
Oh, he's
got me beat, yeah. Except he's only a punter.
Victor Jackson back at the 10-yard line. Partridge standing at the 40. He's got a brother that punts for the Express.
That's right. It's like the Zendejas brothers. They're everywhere.
As kickers stick together,
that's
don't
right.
And they don't get the snap off in time.
He's trying to draw him offside, Roger.
Well,
it was 4th and 4. If they get the offsides, they got the automatic first down. And he's going to only be at the 15. He's still got a shot to put it out inside the 20, so it was a good play.
Well, all honesty, the officials let about another second or two go before they decided it was too much time.
They kept waiting for the snap, and there wasn't one.
Partridge on the year, an average of 39 yards a kick. He's had 8 down inside the 20-yard line, and ideally that's what they'd like to do right now.
This is about the extent of it. When you're at the, when you've got about 50 yards to punt, you ought to be able to put it out inside the 20 consistently, especially with only one deep back.
1:43 left to go in the first quarter, and the Generals with a 3-0 lead. Not a real good kick. Jackson will come up to the 15. And to the 25-yard line, Victor Jackson brings it back. 31 yards on the punt, and we'll return to the Meadowlands in just one moment. Crowd still coming in as traffic backed up outside.
This is an early night.
Yes, it is. 7 o'clock kickoff. Renegades, 1st and 10 from the 25-yard line. Bledsoe stumbles over one of his own men, and that was the center, Mark Fisher, who was driven back by Emmanuel Weaver. And consequently, maybe a gain of a half yard as Bledsoe worked his way up. Yeah, this team has been held, Mike, to 17 points or less in 6 of their 7 losses. So they have really struggled offensively this year. They're the 13th ranked team offensively in the USFL, 9th in the rush, 14th in the pass.
Yes, they are watching the education of a young quarterback.
Pass intended for Nizolik, 89, the tight end, and just off his hand, Vanell Daniel, 23, on the coverage.
Bob Nizolik was a victim of the run and shoot. He was the fine tight end with the Denver Gold last year. Then when Miles Davis installed the run and shoot at Denver this year, he had to move to another team because they don't have tight ends in the run and shoot. He's a fine receiver. His problem, just about a step too slow. And in that situation there with Collier's big arm, it was the reason.
Collier, 3 of 6, 42 yards with that interception. As on 3rd down and 9, they'll go to the shotgun. That was Jerry Parrish in motion. He's got his man, that's Joey Walters, and he's got enough for the first down at the 38-yard line. Jerry Holmes, the veteran from West Virginia, comes up to make the tackle, and he has had a lot of protection so far. We speak of Reggie Collier.
Collier, probably his best throwing first quarter in the whole season. Joey Walters, I watched up in Canada. I mean, this guy caught 100 passes a year while he was up there. When he came down to Federals, he couldn't do much.
And well, maybe with the Federals didn't do
yeah,
much.
Yeah, that's part of it. And I've got a feeling now with the young quarterback that more and more Joey Walters will get into the offense.
Henry Odom, 36, has moved into the slot on the near side on a 1st and 10 from the 39-yard line. And Nizolik, the tight end, and he's got another first down at midfield. That is the 5th first down for the Orlando Renegades. Weddington, 52, and Kerry Justin, 26, come over to make the tackle. Nizolik, 6'5", 250. He's got the size for the tight end spot.
You'll notice nobody's covering because they're playing zone, and they play zone a bunch in the USFL. And with a young quarterback, what you want to do is throw to your tight end in zones.
And that ends the first quarter of play from the Meadowlands in East Rutherford, New Jersey. The Generals leading the Renegades 3-0. For the Orlando Renegades so far this year, they have been outscored 74-20, and it doesn't get any better in the third quarter. Maybe they can change things around here tonight as Bledsoe takes it across midfield to the 48-yard line. Gain of a couple on the play. So far, Collier 5 of 8 for 67 yards, and the Renegades with 5 first downs, so they have been able to move the ball, Mike.
Would
and
you...
I, There's a blast from the past.
There it is. Johnny Unitas and Jim Turner live, huh?
It's Maurice Clemens, 59, and Bobby Leopold also wears those black high tops. He's got them taped up tonight, though.
You know, you mentioned this stat about Orlando in the first quarter doing well. Maybe they figure out that they're outmatched, and then the second quarter the roof caves in.
Second and eight. Bledsoe, once again, as they run the right side, he gets down to the 45-yard line. James Lockett, 96, who's the leading sack man for the Generals. One of the guys there, and Emmanuel Weaver, 69. Jim Byrne, 74, also does a good job. There's first quarter statistics for you. And time of possession, total yards, passing yards. That's interesting, isn't it? Orlando, 67, New Jersey, 22. The rushing yards is interesting, too, because Orlando hasn't done anything there at all.
Herschel got it all, and Orlando's doing nothing. Just what we expected, though. Reggie Collier, the offense for Orlando.
They're the 13th rated offensive team in the United States Football League, as Parrish was the man in motion on a third down and five, and he's got Walters at the 40. That'll be very close to a first down. In third down situations before that particular play, Orlando was 2 of 3. We'll see where they mark the football.
Oh,
looks like it's going
to
be enough.
They'll give it to him. Receivers catch the football, and then their forward momentum because of the tackle takes them up, and he had the first down by a good yard and a half.
Walters came into the game, 19 receptions for 243 yards. Hasn't caught a touchdown pass this year, but then again, Goldstein has started the year, and Collier have not thrown many.
When you've got the learning process with a young quarterback, it's the receivers that suffer most.
First down and 10 at the 39-yard line. Bledsoe goes back into the eye. Give it to Klatt. Quick hitter. Make that Henry Odom, who has just checked into the game. Odom is 36, first-year man from South Carolina State. Jim Byrne, 74, comes up to make the tackle. You know, Lee Corso telling us today that outside of Curtis Bledsoe, they're a little thin at the running back spot.
Yeah, they are. And if you're, as he said today, I've got to have the ball in our offense's hands for about 35, 37 minutes. And if you're going to do that, you better have a running back like Herschel Walker and not the class of running backs that he has to work with.
Second and nine. Collier intercepted. Intercepted by Donnell Daniel. He has got free sailing. Joey Walters comes all the way across field to knock out Daniel at the 8-yard line. Second interception by the New Jersey Generals of Reggie Collier.
Roger, it looks like two receivers got into the same area. See the tight end making an adjustment there? Now they got a back out of the backfield.
So Odom.
And yes, it was. And I think quarterback Reggie Collier got mixed up because of the mistake by the two receivers. And then he gets it picked off. He made a silly throw because he got a misread from his running back coming out of the backfield.
First interception of the year for Donnell Daniel. 59 yards on the return. And the Generals have it first and goal from the 8-yard line. And it's Walker Wright. Herschel inside the 5, down to the 3. 56 Ron Freeman, one of the men there. Also Victor Jackson, number 20. And Lee Corso told us they have to play near-perfect football to beat this team, and so far they're not.
There are very few running backs, Roger, who can make an instant decision on whether I'm going to use power or speed. And you see there, he says, well, there's no hole, so I don't use my speed. Now I lower my neck and use those big upper body muscles to just run over somebody. Next time he'll find a hole and use his 4-4 speed.
Second and goal from the 3, Carthen and Walker, the running backs. This is Herschel. He is stopped at the 4-yard line. West, 28, almost had him in the backfield. And then it was Freeman, 56. And Atkins, 55. And loss of about a yard on that play to bring up a third down.
I don't like that call. When you're going to run a sweep on the goal line, you better be outside the 4-yard line. If you're inside the 4, the 3 or the 2, you run it straight ahead, and you give a great back with that kind of power the ability to jump over, to take somebody on, or sprint through a hole. If you run him on a sweep, you got a chance of losing yards, and they did.
Third and goal from the 4-yard line. Flutie. Still on his feet. Throws a pass. Touchdown! Sam Bowers! talk about a whirling dervish on a football field. What's the pirouette?
Now, this is no plan. There is no plan to this play whatsoever. What it was a naked bootleg, and he wanted to run it in the end zone. Now, it's all the athletic ability of Doug Flutie. And Sam Bowers, the Fordham flash, is right there when he needs him.
Ruzek, the point after, it's good. Well, I'll tell you, Ed Jackson, 50, had a good shot at him. Kevin Kellen, 94, had a good shot.
Improvise, young man.
But for Doug Flutie, his 11th touchdown pass of the year, and the Generals take a 10-0 lead.
Right this minute, Doug Flutie has absolutely no idea the way this play is going to turn out. He thinks it's a naked bootleg, and he's going to skip into the end zone. Now watch him disappear. I mean, he vanishes, and the defense doesn't know where he is. All of a sudden, he pops out, finds 89 Bowers, and it's six.
You know, they called Bob Cousy the Houdini of the hardwood. I think you're going to have to call Doug Flutie the Houdini of the
artificial
football field
turf.
Or the artificial turf.
I like it.
Harry would have been proud of it.
Yes, he would have. Right out of the handcuffs and the chains.
So the mistake, the interception, leads to the touchdown, and Ruzek kicks it off, and Parrish back deep at the four-yard line. All right, Parrish is just nailed. That was 38, Clarence Harmon. 10-0, Generals lead the Renegades. We'll be back to the Meadowlands right after this. Orlando Renegades, four touchdown passes earlier this year. But he'd only thrown four TD passes in the seven games since, so maybe he's going to change that around a bit tonight as Orlando takes it over. First and 10, and here is a naked bootleg, and that is Reggie Collier. And he hits Odom, and Odom is hit as he takes it up past the 25 to the 26-yard line.
Collier.
Jerry Holmes, the man who made the tackle. Collier now, 7 of 11 for over 80 yards.
Holmes figured a way out to cover Walters. Grab a hold of the shoulder pads and slow him down a little bit. Now, at the end of this play, and you won't be able to see it here, but Walters is a little bit upset. He threw it to Odom because he was open, but so was Walters deep. And he'll go back to the huddle now and say, Reggie, next time we run the route, watch for me.
Second and one. Ball at the 26. Double tight end alignment and movement. Looked like the center.
Daniel Weaver. Popped him on the head. Did the center move it a little bit quick?
I don't know whether the center was trying to shake a fly loose or if Emmanuel Weaver popped him on the head. And Collier's really upset.
Oh, they're going to call it against the offensive center.
Yeah, they're going to talk about it.
Mark Fisher wiggled a pinky.
Procedure against the center.
Well, I thought I caught that.
The old offensive lineman in your... came out, Roger.
Bill Parkinson is the referee. The umpire is Carl Pagawelli. The head linesman, Hayden Terry. The line judge, Larry Hill. The back judge, Chet DiStefano. The side judge, Ted Colano. And the field judge, Bob Mantooth. And I got to tell you what, Fisher is upset.
Now he can't even breathe when he's up over the center before somebody jumps offside and he gets called. He's not happy. He's still screaming at him.
He probably just had a fly in his nose or something.
Is that what, yeah. Did you use that excuse?
That's the excuse I would use.
I like it.
Second and six now from the 21-yard line. 10:09 to go in the first half. The Generals lead the Renegades 10-0. Oh, now Walters and Holmes. And Walters, was he trying to get the jump on him or he just lead with a right cross?
I don't know. He can't count to three, I'll tell you.
I guess Walters figured if he was going to get a false start, he was going to let Holmes have a good shot.
That's right. Boy, with this offense, you can't be marching backwards.
No, you sure can't.
Doesn't help.
No, they're in good shape. They passed on first down at a second one. Now they're back, second and 11 at the 16-yard line.
I like the way Corso's mixing it up on offense. He's giving Collier every opportunity to be the kind of athlete that can get some yardage, and then the offensive line takes 10 yards away from it.
Well, they've been penalized a couple of times now for 10 yards. Collier deflected at the line of scrimmage and almost picked off. Freddie Gilbert, number 90, who hasn't made a lot of tackles this year. He's got four sacks, was the man who got his hand up. He's 6'4", 280, his second year from... How about them dogs?
How about them dogs? Yes. There's one on offense, one on defense. Now they bring in the three wide receivers. And you'll see Reggie more than likely go into the shotgun. They bring in Smith, 87, and really try to put pressure on that zone defense. We've seen Collier go over the middle a couple of times to his tight end,
problem here is got to have 12 yards. I don't know if his tight ends are fast enough to get deep.
Three out of four on third down situations. It is third and 11. Collier, little sprint out. Bledsoe gets a handle on it, and he's knocked out at the 21-yard line.
Little protection play, we call that on offense. Instead of putting Collier in the situation where he's got to pick up 12 yards by making a great throw, nine times out of ten he'll throw the interception. He runs the option out of it, hoping he can fool the defense. Didn't get him too much yards and didn't get him the first down, but also didn't turn the ball over in his territory.
Ross Armstrong was the man that made the tackle. As you take a look at Greg Cater, averaging almost 43 yards a punt so far this year. And the man back deep for the Generals is Danny Knight. Cater's earlier punt, 45 yards, standing at his own 6-yard line. Boy, that's a high spiraling punt. Knight, fair catch, 33. Loopy Sanchez is right down there. And the Generals will have it first and 10 when we return to the Meadowlands. Roger Twybo, Mike Hafner back with you. Generals will take it over. First and 10 last week. Actually, they've had about 10 days off. They had a 21-18 victory over Memphis. Good win there for him. Flutie threw just 12 passes in that game, completed 7. One was a touchdown. He's going to the air again. Sideline job. Herschel Walker, or I should say sidearm pass, which he had become famous for. That's the second sidearm tonight.
When
Ron
you
Freeman,
are,
56, yeah. made the tackle.
When you're 5'9", you learn to throw it lots of ways to get out of the way of the pass rush. Get Herschel Walker out of the back. Here's another fear for a linebacker. Not only can he hurt you when he's running right at you because he'll run over you, but he's a fine pass receiver.
Leading pass receiver on the Generals.
Something that I think a lot of scouts didn't know anything about when he came out of Georgia. And obviously in college, why would you throw it to him? You want him running it.
Second down and 2, and it's Herschel right. You got to feel for Victor Jackson. That's about the fourth or fifth time so far tonight he's had a one-on-one situation with Herschel Walker. And since Victor goes about 6 feet 190, and Herschel goes about 6'1", 225.
See what I said about giving away 20 pounds or more? You never want to see that guy coming around the corner with his shoulders squared at you. Then you know you're going to get hurt. That time he had his shoulders towards the sidelines and he could just push him out.
Walt Michaels, very successful as a player professionally and also a pretty good coach of the Jets. Flutie, he's got Bowers. He makes the catch at the 28-yard line. Back on the coverage with Jeff George, number 43, as Flutie has found his tight end tonight, Sam Bowers.
What happens when you play four down linemen and four linebackers? That means you've got to play a three-deep zone in the secondary. Your two outside receivers are covered. You put a back out of the backfield and a tight end down the other seam, and one of them is going to be wide open, and Flutie just dropped it right into Bowers. Nobody around him.
29 yards on the reception, and it's first and 10. Four first downs now in the night for the New Jersey Generals. Ball at the 25-yard line with 8:13 to go in the half. And it's Herschel Wright inside the 25 to the 23-yard line. Herschel Walker, five of six games that the Generals have won over 100 yards, and 10-1 the last two seasons when he's gone over 100 yards. So it's safe to say when this guy runs for over 100, this is a winning football team.
That's right. 64-76, Harrison Maggs off the right side. And there is the prime example of why the 4-4 defense works. They shut Herschel down. As soon as you turn around, throw it into that zone, though, you're going to hurt him, and they have.
Second and 9. Flutie sacked. 66, Scott Hutchison with his third and a half sack on the year. Kellen, 94, was also in there. That time, a straight drop back, Mike.
One thing that I've got a feeling you should never do with Flutie. Always move him a little bit so that he has an opportunity to get out of the way of people instead of setting back up at 7 yards where they know exactly where he is and they can use their height to keep him from throwing and then sack him.
13th time this year he's been sacked. Last week was not sacked. They didn't have a turnover. That was the second time this year that that had happened. The first game against Orlando was the other time. So they'd had two perfect games with no turnovers, no sacks. It's not going to happen tonight. As Flutie goes deep, penalty marker is down. Broughton was the intended receiver, and Albert Gray was back on the coverage. But there is a penalty marker down in the Generals' backfield.
Walter Broughton didn't think that Flutie could zing it out there, and he slowed down. He wouldn't have. That would have been 6. It was a perfect throw.
Fourth down.
The penalty was against New Jersey, but it has been declined by the Orlando Renegades. Yeah, fourth down situation. You don't want to give Flutie another chance.
No,
he can do too many things.
Yeah, you take the penalty and he'll scramble around to you and then dump one off to Herschel and he'll go 60 on you.
Rick Partridge will come in to hold as Ruzek will attempt the field goal.
50-yarder.
Going to put it down right at the 50. He is 5 out of 7 on the year. He has not tried one of 50 yards or more this year.
It's into the wind a little bit, too,
yes,
if there is any.
Got the height. Just falls short. Just a couple feet, right on line. And that wind was the difference.
If he'd have been kicking the other way, he'd have made it.
So Ruzek, 1-2 on the night, and New Jersey, a 10-0 lead. We shall find out. We'll have all the coverage for you right here on ESPN. First and 10 for the Orlando Renegades with 6:07 left to go in the first half. And the Generals holding a 10-0 lead. Henry Odom was the ball carrier. He got a couple of yards. The defense for the Generals, not really that impressive. You look at stats, 7th against the rush, 12th against the pass, and Collier has been able to pass against them tonight.
He's about to try it again, too, right here.
2nd and 8.
Two tight ends.
Two wideouts. But they give it to Bledsoe.
Oh!
Bledsoe very close to the first down at the 44-yard line. Jerry Holmes, 37, and also Maurice Clemens, 59. And that was a nice play.
Yes, the beauty of offense.
Little delay.
All of us figuring, hey, they're going to throw the football here. Same way the Generals' defense.
You said they were going to
throw the football. And they run the drive, and they run the drop play and fool you.
And Walt thought they were going to throw the football.
Absolutely. That's why the play worked.
7th first down now for Orlando as Odom will move into the slot on the near side. With just 5 minutes left to go in the first half. Straight up the middle. Boy, that was a tough hit right there. Emmanuel Weaver, 69. Really gave him a shot. And Bledsoe across the 45 to the 46-yard line. Keep in mind, stay with us at halftime. We'll update you on everything that's transpired in those United States Football League meetings that took place this afternoon. They will be going to the fall of 86.
Also, another major signing by the Tampa Bay Bandits. Stole Wendell Tyler from the San Francisco 49ers, the Super Bowl champion.
Interesting sign.
Yes, very interesting.
Wendell doesn't know when he's going to be playing.
Could have a year and a half off, huh?
Collier got Mazolik, and Mazolik is stuck. Jerry Holmes gave him a good pop. He's very close to the first down. Oh, Holmes put a hurt on you, doesn't he?
Now you know why tight ends are 6'5", 235 pounds, so they can take shots like that.
Just short of the first down, and it'll be third down for the Orlando Renegades, trailing 10-0. Lee Corso's got to be proud of his defense so far because they've been able to hold on a couple of occasions. And the one touchdown on the very good field position on the interception.
Interception, absolutely. Only a 10-point deficit with halftime rolling towards them. He's got to be proud of his club for scrapping.
Third down, Odom doesn't get it.
Oh, hold it, stop it. Whoa, hold it. Let's go.
They send Walters in motion to the near side. Odom right up the middle. And Freddie Gilbert, number 90, was right there at a meeting. Odom's just 5'9", 205, and they're going to measure it. What do you think, Mike?
It's not a first down. Eyes never fail me.
With 3:29 to go in the half.
And I go for it, too.
Sure you would. Well, you're 2-7.
Nothing to lose. Plus, you got a year off after June.
Sure. Well, they like to think of it as this year ending in July and then training camp the following
starts
July.
The next one.
Right.
Sure.
So that's a year, right?
Yeah.
We were talking earlier with some of the people from the league, and they said, well, it's really only 4 or 5 months. And I said, well, okay.
Sure.
I didn't quite understand the arithmetic, but...
Well, they figure the paychecks come first in the 15th, so they can count whenever they want.
Fourth down, and the Gades will go for it.
And I'll bet Lee Corso will be bent right down the line to see if he gets this one.
This is maybe one of those times where they'll draw a play up for Collier.
In the dirt? They did that last week and got a big play. There's no dirt to draw out up there. It's artificial surface.
Bledsoe is the lone setback. Collier tries to sneak it. I don't think he got it. Well, you've got a problem there. That offensive line of the Orlando Renegades, just not the power to drive people off the ball. That's why you have to question that particular call.
If they give it to him, it's a gift, and I don't even think they're going to measure it because he didn't move it but maybe an inch or inch or two.
No, they're going to measure it.
Well, they can ask for it. Let's take a look. See, you were absolutely right, Roger. There's no surge from the offensive line. Leopold says, absolutely no way, man. Orlando, even to get a breather here, will call for a measurement, but they're a good 6 inches short.
Ready. Generals hold. So with 3:12 left to go in the first half, their offense gets good field position one more time at the 46-yard line. And they have found the tight end, Sam Bowers, on numerous occasions this evening.
He said they had to stop one or the other, Flutie or Walker, and they haven't stopped either one.
First and 10 from the 46-yard line. Almost intercepted. 43, Jeff George had it and couldn't hold on to it. The intended receiver was Clarence Collins.
One of the tendencies for Doug Flutie, because of his height, is that he'll, in order to get the ball over the top of those tall people, he'll let it fly every once in a while, and that one goes right up over the top, and George should intercept it. It was right to him.
Jeff's got three interceptions on the year. That would have put another notch on the belt for him.
You know what he was doing? He's coming up to make the tackle because he thought it'd be a great throw, and he had to readjust to try to catch it, and he couldn't quite do it.
Second and 10 from the 46, 2:51 to go first half. Flutie's got Walker in front of him, throws the block, and Doug lays down at the 49-yard line. I think it was a little indecision there on whether he should slide or what. Kelvin Atkins at 6'3 and 235 was bearing down on him. Possibly running out of bounds would have been the right thing
to do. I think that would have been the wise choice. You know, another thing, too, on artificial surface, when it hadn't been raining, it's tough to slide.
Yeah, it is.
You catch the cleats in there, you get yourself a sprained ankle or a torn ligament.
The Orlando defense last in the United States Football League, last against the rush, ninth against the pass. They've only got 9 sacks so far this year, 10 including the one tonight.
A lot of that is because their offense leaves them on the field for most of the game.
Out of the shotgun, 3rd and 5. Flutie, the sidearm pass to Herschel Walker and a first down. Penalty marker down. Atkins made the tackle at the 42-yard line. And it looks like it's going to be a face mask.
56 on the defense, 5-yard penalty.
Yeah, got to tackle him.
Well, the face mask call was on Freeman.
Herschel Walker on the crossing pattern in the situation where you need a first down. Watch Doug Flutie's arm. I'll tell you what, if you can't throw it over him, throw it around him. And Herschel ran a nice route.
They called it on the wrong man.
Yes.
It wasn't on Freeman, it was on Atkins.
Well, you ask how to tackle him, ankles or shoulders, and when in doubt, grab his face mask and pull him down.
2-minute warning. The Generals lead the Renegades 10-0. I know Donald Trump's one very happy man tonight.
Yeah, he said, hey, Roger, where were those 10 votes for the spring?
Yeah. 2 minutes left to go. First half, first and 10 from the 35-yard line, and Herschel goes left. And he goes inside the 30, down to the 27-yard line. Freeman, 56, one of the guys in on the tackle, and also 59, Harold Randolph, another linebackers, as they will speed it up right now with the clock running and 1:45 left to go in the first half.
You can tell when Herschel Walker gets his shoulders squared to the line of scrimmage, there's a roar that comes out of the crowd. They know that one every other time he's going to bust one.
Walker with 8 carries for 82 yards. Flutie is going to run it. He's going to turn it up, and he runs out at the 15-yard line. Another first down for the New Jersey Generals, and that's why you have to keep him contained inside.
One of the most important things for defensive end is to rush straight up the field first and then pinch in on Doug Flutie. Watch what happens when they take the inside rush on him, and then with his quickness, the vanishing Houdini gets outside of you, he's had three carries for 23 yards, and this one probably hurt the worst because it was in the two-minute drill. And he just stepped out of bounds and stopped the clock. Didn't have to waste one of their three remaining timeouts.
First and 10 from the 15. Herschel to the left side. Herschel on his feet inside the five, down to the four. And once again, for Victor Jackson, who started the evening at 6 feet, 195, will probably end the evening at 5'9", about 210.
That's right. His neck definitely be down between his shoulder blades.
Well, he won't be able to shirt button, that's for sure.
That was the best combination run by Herschel Walker. Tiptoed, used his speed to get through the hole, then saw he had to use his power, and Jackson took the brunt of it.
Generals with all three of their timeouts left. 10-0, 103 left to go, first half. Remember, Orlando went for it on fourth down. Walker, fumble. Renegades get it. Harold Randolph, 59, fourth-year man from East Carolina. And Herschel Walker fumbles the football. And Randolph, the reserve linebacker, had it all by himself. There were nothing but white shirts back there.
And he didn't even have to recover. Once you fumble it in the end zone, it goes back out the outside. Herschel tried to make a great move in a hole, and he got the ball yanked right out of his hands.
Kevin Kellen
jerked it out of his hands. And if that ball would have been fumbled, gone out of the end zone, still was a touchback, whether he recovered it or not.
So, 51 seconds left to go on the half. First and 10 from the 20-yard line. Orlando with two timeouts remaining, and once again the clock stops on first down while the chains are moved.
51 seconds left. You're on your own 20-yard line. You're down by 10 points. Do you try to do the two-minute drill? There's the guy that makes the recovery.
Harold Randolph.
Do you go and try and score, or do you make sure you don't turn it over and give them an extra three or an extra seven?
You're 2-7. You don't have to say anything.
I'd go for it. Put it up top.
And Collier is looking to pass, and he's got Nizolik. Wisely steps out of bounds at the 28-yard line, a couple yards shy of a first down, but he does stop the clock. Over on the coverage was Kerry Justin, the veteran from Oregon State, who comes into this game with four interceptions, a fumble recovery, took one of those back for a touchdown on the interception. You know, there was also another guy in the secondary, Gary Barbaro, who was signed from the Kansas City Chiefs,
right.
But he's been injured, bad knee. They don't know
yes.
if he'll ever come back.
He's got one of those they've got to reconstruct, and there are a lot of guys sitting out. William Andrews at Atlanta. They don't know about a lot of the fine stars in both leagues who have had those kind of surgeries.
Orlando has asked for a timeout here, so apparently some confusion on their offense because they were able to get out of bounds to stop the clock. Now they have just one timeout left to go here in the first half, and the ball resting at the 28-yard line.
Isn't that Cliff Stout's best buddy?
Derek Batiste. Well, I'll tell you what happened. Good crowd in Jacksonville, and I think Lindy Infante and Ed Luther and company has got to put together Batiste. A couple of interceptions, one for a 12-yard touchdown less than 2 minutes ago, and then another one right at the end of the game. Jim Kelly, well, four TD passes, three TD passes in the third quarter alone, include a 69-yarder to Gerald McNeil. How about that man, Clarence Verdan?
102-yard kickoff return. That man's got to be, he's faster than the wind. Third 90-plus kickoff return. I'll tell you what, offenses and defenses love kids like that on special teams.
Second and two from the 28-yard line. Four wide receivers in the game right now for Orlando as Collier rolls to the near side. Downfield, he's got a man right there. That was Jerry Parrish. And they're going to say he was out of bounds.
I'd throw the red flag here if I were Lindy Infante. He was in bounds.
Lee Corso. Ross Armstrong was the man on the coverage, and let's see what Corso is going to do.
Let's take a look. Let's see if we go red flag here. Oh, I'll tell you what, that was real close.
And the red flag just went.
Good.
The red flag
Good.
Just went. Now we have Cal Lepore, the head of USFL officials here tonight. If this is not successful, this would be the last timeout for
yes.
Orlando in this half.
Absolutely. Another real close look. I'll tell you what, the right toe, I don't know if we can tell on this one. The other replay was better.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you what, it looks to me like both feet were in. Of course, I'm
go.
A receiver.
Blitnikoff did this so well for so many
yeah.
years.
See that
right
toe?
Right toe was in.
Absolutely
right toe
the right
was
toe was in. And the left was clearly in.
Now, Corso has not won so far this year. He told us earlier today he was 0 for 2.
And he said he didn't like it, and he wouldn't use it. And he's pretty unhappy right there.
Reggie's saying, hey, man, my stats are in balance here. That's a lot of yards and a completion. Now, it's going to get us down here scoring territory.
I feel for California because you must be 100% sure. It might be 99% that both feet are in. And if he goes by the letter of the law, he's going to have to
You've got the main man. Here tonight. Cal
That's
is
right.
the head of USFL officials, and he is the review official sitting up and watching our replays.
I had a good talk with him today, and he said he really likes the red flag rule. He says, I think it worked. I think we've been fair, and I think they have.
So, Lee Corso looking for his first win of the year versus the officials.
Oh, he's got a smile on his face. Must mean he won.
He's Keep in mind, Calipore is watching the same replays that you at home saw.
That's true.
And
you know what he's doing right there? He's asking his side judge, did you see it perfectly and clearly? If he says, yes, sir, Cal will say, it's incomplete. If he says, I have a little bit of doubt, then Cal will call it and say it's good.
I thought, though, that Cal's supposed to make that decision not to go back down to the field.
Well, I don't know. He'll go... Because he had a better view.
The pass is ruled as completed pass.
Okay, Corso won it.
The old receiver's got good eyes.
Corso won it. He's excited about it. Look at Corso. Okay, here we go. We got to get things going now.
That's the first one he's won this year.
27 yards on the completion. Parrish made the reception, just his third of the year. He is usually their kickoff return man. That's what he does on a regular basis. But with the four wideouts, Parrish will be in there. So now they do not lose the timeout. They have the one timeout left. 39 seconds left to go. First and 10, the ball at the 45-yard line. And if they don't get a score, maybe they can get a field goal out of it.
That's the key. Go in with the edge emotionally if they can get points on the board.
Penalty marker goes down.
63 on the offense.
Offensive right guard.
Tom
left
Dornbrook.
Guard.
Fourth year out of Kentucky. Who played so well for the Michigan Panthers their first year.
All USFL.
Won a championship up there. Had a serious knee injury last year. So that'll move him back to midfield. Parrish comes split to the near side with Joey Walters. Smith and Flowers are split to the far side. This is Joey Walters. He's got it. At the 8-yard line, carries his man down to the 6. That was Ross Armstrong, 28. One of the men back on the coverage. 45 yards on the reception. Also back there, Donnell Daniel and Gregory Johnson.
How many times have I told you that Walters has come back to the huddle and said, Reggie, I'm open when you throw the combination pass to my side. Here he runs the corner route, and Collier says, all right, if you're open, I'm going to throw it to you. And that was a perfect throw. See how he takes the time off the ball and drops it right in? It's for a young, strong-arm young man, this is a difficult throw because he's got to drop it over the linebackers. And there's a perfect view of it. 63 yards, 3 catches
for Walters.
For Walters.
45 yards on that pass reception. And so, the red flag victory for Lee Corso
could
at this moment, with 31 seconds left to go on a half, and they have got life here, trailing 10-0 with a chance to get on the scoreboard. They used their last timeout now, so Orlando with no timeouts remaining.
And don't run it here, Roger.
No.
You throw 3 passes and you tell Collier, if he's not open, throw it up to the 50th row.
31 seconds left to go in the half. No timeouts left for the Renegades.
50th row, not quite, but he did throw it away.
He had his tight ends, Nizolik and Eccles, both back in the corner. Eccles is complaining that somebody was holding on to me, and I noticed that Lee Corso on the sideline was drawing a play.
He makes them up as he goes along. He said that to us today.
Well, you know what they'll do on something like that? He'll tell his quarterback, Collier, that he is making up this play. Collier will call a play, and all of his players think it's going to be this specific
something
play.
Else.
And only Collier knows it's going to be something else, so they don't mess up a blocking scheme. They just do what they're supposed to do.
That's great coaching, I guess.
Second and goal from the 6-yard line. They flooded the right side, and that's where Collier's going. He throws it in the end zone. The reception was made, but they say no. Collier defender stepped out of bounds at the 12-yard line. The reception in the end zone by Jackie Flowers, I don't know if he was in bounds. Nonetheless, they say Collier stepped out at the 12.
We'll find out if Flowers was in, but it's a moot point because Collier was out of bounds when he threw the football. It's the roll and the flood pattern as you described. And what you do is try and get a guy short and a guy long. And we'll see. Collier, oh, wait a minute. He wasn't out
of
bounds.
Goodness sakes, he wasn't out of bounds.
Not out of bounds. Now, there's the reception in the end zone,
he was definitely out. But Collier was not out of bounds when he threw the football. No, Lee, not yet.
Not yet, Lee. Now you want a field goal here.
Third and goal from the 12. 19 seconds left to go in the half. You don't want to get out of field goal range. Down the middle, he's got his big tight end, Nizolik, and they bring him down at the 3. Now the clock is running. 10 seconds.
It's a first down, though. That'll stop the clock. There's
Oh,
it's fourth down.
No, it's goal to go.
That's right. It'll run out.
They can't get it. They can't get it. So a strange ending to the first half here at the Meadowlands in East Rutherford, New Jersey. The Generals lead the Renegades 10-0. Interception returned, and Walker fumbled in the end zone, and then Orlando held defensively on a couple of occasions. Passing yardage, 177 for Orlando, just 64 for New Jersey, but rushing yardage, big night there. Herschel has really done it, 122 yards to just 24, and total yards, 201 to 186. Not many turnovers, just 3, but a costly couple of turnovers for Orlando, and time of possession, New Jersey, with just about a minute more.
The key here is that it's only 10-0.
Mm-hmm.
If they could have gotten in the end zone or even a field goal at the end, they'd have come out with at least some inspiration. Now, usually, Orlando doesn't have the second half. And if they can't keep the emotion up, I've got a feeling that Flutie and Walker are going to have a big, big second half.
Well, they've been outscored 74-20 in the second quarter and 57-20 in the third quarter of games this year. Their first and fourth quarter production has been very positive. The second and third quarters for Orlando have not been. And Doug Flutie, I'll tell you, that one touchdown pass where he did a pirouette on the far side and came back and found Bowers in the end zone. That was something. Orlando trailing 10-0. And as Mike said at the end of the first half, when they won the red flag situation and moved it right down and just couldn't get the field goal team in on time after completing the pass to Nizolik, and consequently they trail 10-0. Brockhouse to kick it off.
Key here is to stop New Jersey the first time they have the ball.
Boy, just a bad kickoff, and I want to say that's Emmanuel Weaver, 69, but we'll have to get a look at it.
That's Bowers.
Bowers?
Big Sam.
Number 89.
Fair
first carries,
camper.
95 yards. I guess it's safe to assume he'll be over the century mark again tonight.
Unless he disappears, he'll make it pretty easy.
Generals will have it first and 10 from the 36-yard line. They'll bring Broughton and Collins to the near side. And it's Herschel, and he is racked up right at the line of scrimmage. Kevin Kellen, 94, and also 55, Kelvin Atkins, both in on the tackle.
And that's the key. You name two guys on the tackle. If you're going to stop Herschel from the long runs, it can't be one-on-one with him. You've got to have two people tackling.
Five previous meetings for Herschel Walker against the Federals / Renegades. Over 100 yards, 4 of the 5 games. And the only time that they lost to the Feds / Gates was when he didn't get 100 yards. Rudy on 2nd and 11 has got room, and he's going to run it. Freeman, though, moves up and forces him out of bounds at the 42-yard line, short of the first down. So a good move by Freeman, who made Flutie commit. And that's what you've got to do to it.
Yes, you do. David Graham, number 68, is the one who doesn't take the outside rush and lets him slip outside. And when you let him do that, Ed McElhaney is the one who had to chase him then.
It was a good thing Freeman came up, or Flutie would have gotten even more yardage and a first down.
Flutie, four carries and 30 yards, and he's faced with a third down situation and four. They have completed 54% of their third down situations this year. Flutie, still on his feet, still going, got the first down.
Pure athletic ability right there.
He's slippery, isn't he?
They pulled his shoe off, and he's still going.
First down.
This is what Doug Flutie has done all of his career. Make up for being 5 foot nine and a half. Find some room to throw the football if you can somebody open. Oh, yeah, he's dead right there. And they keep saying, well, he'll run out of bounds or he'll fall down like all quarterbacks do. And he doesn't. And look at the block. That's nice to see a Heisman Trophy winner and a 100-yard gainer get down on the ground, get dirty.
Herschel left with room. Penalty marker. Going to get a clip. Herschel goes out at the 35-yard line, but a penalty flag is down, and it is going to be against New Jersey.
81, Jeff Speck, looked like he tried to peel back block and got somebody in the back of the legs. He's trying to get the number. It looked like 81.
And he'll step off 10 yards. The New Jersey Generals, after this meeting with Orlando, will have to travel to the Gator Bowl in Jacksonville. And the way Lindy and Ponte and Ed Luther got put together right now, that could be an interesting matchup coming up on May the 5th. First and 20 from the 38. All day, going deep. Broughton drags the tackle down to the 26-yard line. Albert Gray was the man who made a touchdown-saving tackle. Flutie, 46 yards on the completion to his wide receiver, Walter Broughton.
It's the first time he's been successful, Roger, on a straight drop-back pass. Outstanding time. And if you give any quarterback, I don't care if he's 6'5 or 5'9, that kind of time is going to find a receiver open. 46 yards.
Longest Broughton. Reception of the year for Broughton. And it's first and 10. The ball at the 26 and Herschel left. And they played it perfectly that time. Good job by 59 Harold Randolph, who really strung it out. Kevin Kellen was also over there, but that's the way you have to play Herschel Walker.
4-4 is the way they're playing. Four down defensive linemen, four linebackers. Four linebackers will stop the outside running game because of the pursuit. And especially when you're getting pressure from four defensive linemen. And the key with Herschel Walker is to get more than one person on the tackle and force him to the sideline so he doesn't get his shoulders turned up so he can use his great speed and his strength.
Sixth time this year, Herschel's been over 100 yards. Remember that disastrous game against Birmingham where he only had 6 yards?
Yeah.
Rushing. Flutie. One man. Cuts it up. Inside the five, down to the 3-yard line.
Man's exciting, isn't he? Doug Flutie does his magic again. Watch this move on the linebacker. Inside head fake, and then outside. And now he's going to cut it back up and even get more yardage. And most quarterbacks will run for the sidelines, and I believe he fooled the Gage defense when he cut back inside. Now he's down at the 2. Now you can use big Herschel Walker and his power.
First and goal from the 2-yard line. Herschel. Touchdown, New Jersey.
You want to be a linebacker and play against Herschel Walker? Here's a look from the end zone, just like the linebackers are seeing it. Look at the nice trap blocking inside, and Herschel just walks in.
11th rushing touchdown of the year for Walker, set up by the 22-yard run by Doug Flutie. Ruzek to attempt the point after. It's good. 10-16 left to go. Third quarter for the Meadowlands. And the Generals have a 17-0 lead. Roger Twivel, Mike After back with you. And, well, they're keeping track of what's going on because they got the Flutie cards up. And Doug Flutie, the 22-yard run. Walker finished it off with a touchdown, John, his 11th of the year. And New Jersey with a 17-0 lead. And they are rolling right now.
Fans are smart here. Herschel might have scored, but the guy who got him there was Flutie.
Ruzek sends it to Parrish at the four. Loses it. Gets it back. Ooh. Starts going bad. It gets real bad. 38, Clarence Harmon, the initial man, on the tackle.
Ruzek's kick. Now here you are. You're the return man. You see all those red jerseys coming down here? The ground kind of shakes. And when that ball, when you've got your back turned, Roger, and you can hear those guys' feet pounding, it's scary. Then he turns around and looks, and look at all the red jerseys coming after him. Oh, that's no way to start when you're down 17-0 in the second half.
So Reggie Collier bring his team up to the line of scrimmage. First and 10 from the 8-yard line. New Jersey, a 17-0 lead. Second meeting of the year between these two teams. Collier throws it out to Joey Walters. And not nearly enough. Got some pressure that time by Mike Weddington.
Lee Corso will send in four wide receivers now. And he's not playing it close to the vest. He might be down 17-0 with the ball sitting on the 8-yard line, but he's going to put it up.
Four wide receivers, Walters and Parrish to the near side. Smith and Broughton. Completion at the 15-yard line.
Zone defense that time by the New Jersey Generals. And with the four wide receivers, what you try to do is not defend the receiver, but defend the pass. And I'll tell you what, if Collier wouldn't have got it there any more quickly, it could have been picked off or incomplete.
Walters, four receptions for 70 yards. Third down and two. Walters splits the top of your screen. Jackie Flowers to the near side. They give it to Bledsoe. He runs hard. The Generals are saying it's not enough. Orlando, 3 of 7 before that play on third down conversions.
In this situation, I'd roll Collier out, give him a chance, option and run or throw. The defensive line of the Generals have been whipping the offensive line of the Renegades all evening. And in this situation, you're just hoping if you're going to run inside to get a first down on third and two.
50, Kyle Borland has been doing a fine job at linebacker. He's been playing a lot tonight with John Joyce out. Big tight end for the Orlando Renegades. Bob Mazzolik walking gingerly off the field. And Greg Cater with a test. He'll be standing at his 2-yard line.
Need a big punt here to save the field position, or New Jersey will take advantage of this one and make it a route.
8:26 to go, third quarter. Knight right at midfield, and Lupe Sanchez is there. Knight's still trying to go. I don't know where he's going to go. General 15, Renegades nothing. Roger Twivel, Mike Hafner back with you. New Jersey with good field position. They put it in play first and 10 from the 44-yard line. Carthen is a lone setback. Walker in the slot to the near side. First time we've seen that formation, and it works. Carthen, very close to a first down. Poor Victor Jackson. I know they're not paying him enough money to tackle Carthen and Walker as many times as he's had to tonight.
You said it right. He comes in the game at about 6 foot and goes out at 5'9". You've got to give him a lot of credit for sticking his head in there. You know what defensive backs say when a hole opens up like this? They say, well, do I take him on head on, And there goes Freeman out of the way,
got a good piece of it.
Yeah, so that Jackson now has to take him on. But do you let him run by and jump on his back, or do you take him on head-on? I think Jackson's going to change his tack after a while.
That was the first down. First and 10 from the 46. Herschel, right? Look out. At the 18-yard line, Elbert Gray finally knocks him out of bounds. Mike, tell everybody about the way Herschel runs. Short, choppy steps, doesn't move his upper body much.
We'll give you a graphic look at it right here. See how steady that 3 and that 4 stay? Now watch when he gets the opening. Look at that burst. How can a man 235 pounds run that fast after just gliding along? I mean, he takes off like he's got two jets in his shoes.
34 yards in the pickup, too.
Doesn't seem like it, does it? He just glides and then, bam!
Well, he's already over 100 yards tonight. Once again, he's in the slot to the near side. First and 10 from the 13. Carthen. He turns it up nicely. Inside the 10 to the 8. Maurice Carthen. Fred McAllister makes the tackle. So Lee Corso, the Renegades, using some new bodies on defense. A lot of those guys taking a lot of shots from Herschel and Carthen so far tonight. Roger. I'll tell you the other thing is you get tired of chasing Flutie around.
You do? I'll tell you, there's the difference in the scoring in the second half against the Gates. You pointed it out. Their depth is not there, and they get tired in the second half, and there's nobody to come in and take their spot.
Second down and 5 from the 8-yard line. Walker, 18 carries, 131 yards. This is Maurice Carthen. And he gets down to the 3-yard line. We talked a little bit earlier about Carthen, 6'1", 221 in his third year from Arkansas State, where he played with Bill Johnson of the Denver Gold. Carthen will be leaving the Generals, but he won't be going far. He will be playing for the Giants.
He's going to stay in the same stadium, just change jerseys.
Makes sense.
Why not? You don't have to buy a new house, move the wife and kids.
Carthen, 5 carries and 24 yards, and they'll bring it in to measure it.
Give Herschel a rest. Let Carthen pound on him for a while.
Thank you. 4 times this year, the Renegades have allowed 30 or more points. And Lee Corso, of course, working with a team put together from a lot of different places. You should look at New Jersey with 214 yards rushing. 7 players from the Renegades, the rest of them picked up through free agency dispersals.
From the Federal.
Yeah. 131 yards, as you saw on the graphic, for Orlando. First and goal, 4-yard line, Speck, the man in motion. Herschel Wright. He is dragged down. Nice tackle. 28 is Bernard West, 6'2", 220, who is a linebacker, changed numbers, was 58 earlier in the day and came out with 28 on.
You know why? They went to the 4-4 set, so he's the fourth sort of linebacker who is also a secondary guy. In-betweeners, 6 foot, 215 pounds, can play linebacker or strong safety. I think it was more to help his teammates than confuse the other team that he changed numbers.
14 first downs on the night for New Jersey. Just under 5 minutes to go. Third quarter. Carthen. Touchdown. See, if Carthen's not going to spike it, he's supposed to give it to one of his offensive linemen.
You can do that in this league. Take another look. And guess who's the lead blocker here? And he gets a pretty good shot, 34, Walker. He gives his running mate, who's been blocking for him all night, Carthen, a chance to get in the end zone.
Mackey, 73, Stroth, 66, and Hull, 58 on the left side as Ruzek attempts the point after, and he is good. And the Generals take a 24-0 lead over the Renegades.
I'll tell you what, teammates love to give you all the accolades. When you block for your teammates every once in a while, they'll let Herschel have his 150, his 200 yards. But if you'll do that, you'll be a hero.
6 plays, 56 yards, 3 minutes and 23 seconds. New Jersey, 24-0. 24-0. 4:52 left to go, third quarter. Parrish This guy's returned over 30 kickoffs this year, and I think he's getting tired. Janelle Daniel, 23, and there is a flag down.
A little unnecessary roughness.
Number 23 on the kicking team. He threw him down.
And they're calling Daniel for it.
He did.
Walt Michaels told us he doesn't mind aggressive penalties.
These he'll let you get away with if it doesn't hurt your club. And they're up 24 to nothing. And to keep his defense interested, Daniel gives him a little extra shove out of bounds. That was a good call. No sense here. You got him stopped. His forward progress is finished. Leave it alone right there. That's what got
him. Should be on 75, though. I mean, if they're going to call it, Daniel was still trying to drag him out. Well, nonetheless.
Take your choice.
A few extra yards for Orlando. First and 10. Nizolik, the tight end. They'll mark him down at the 45-yard line, and he has been the primary target so far of Reggie Collier this evening. He has paid the price. There you see six plays, 56 yards, 3 minutes and 23 seconds, and Maurice Carthon, the 3-yard touchdown run.
3:23, the ideal drive time.
Nizolik, 6 receptions, 67 yards, came into this game, averaging over 11 yards a reception. 18 yards on that pickup, and it's first and 10 from the 45. Collier's got some room, and he's going to go out of bounds. Maurice Clemens, 59, was the closest man to him. We haven't seen Reggie do that tonight. We mentioned at the top of the show, only carried it 4 times last week.
That's his first carry tonight, I believe.
First carry of that kind outside, we're primarily right. Designed to run with the football.
In order to put pressure on defenses, you got to put pressure on their corners. You got to have the great back who can run the sweep. You got to have the quarterback who can roll out and be a threat to run, which Collier is.
He's got 9 touchdowns on the ground this year.
Absolutely. They haven't got the great back to get outside, so they've got to use him in that run-pass situation. They really haven't done it.
Well, they haven't been able to utilize Bledsoe very much this season. 2nd and 5, ball right at midfield. Collier, he's got Odom. And that'll be enough for the first down at the 44-yard line. We see, and we've got to confirm this, but I think Ricky Klatt, who played just the first couple of plays of the game, see a guy in plain clothes down in the sidelines for Orlando on crutches.
And we haven't seen Klatt.
No, we haven't seen Klatt, and we haven't heard that he was injured, but from up here it looks like Ricky Klatt, so Odom has been carrying the brunt of the duty with Bledsoe in the backfield on a 1st and 10, ball at the 44-yard line. Double tight end alignment. Look out. Boy, Collier did a good job to get it away, as right in his face was number 74, Jim Byrne, who already has 4.5 sacks this year from Wisconsin La Crosse.
Byrne takes the inside move and is on Collier before he even gets a chance. They're trying to set up a screen. Guard pulled, so Byrne went on the inside. And we've been raving about 22 Doug Flutie for the Generals and his great athletic ability. Mr. Collier doesn't quite have the athletes around him that Flutie does, and he's just as good an athlete, believe us.
Collier with just 2 carries for 5 yards, 15 of 23 in the passing department for 210, a couple of interceptions. He's been sacked 13 times this year coming into this game. Bledsoe, good job of running by Bledsoe as he is inside the 40 down to the 36-yard line. That time he was just pushing and moving his center, Mark Fisher, 57, and his left guard, Tom Dornbrook, 63. Let's talk a little bit ago about how there are just 7 players from the original Washington Federals that are left on this franchise. And they've got a plan of attack down there at Orlando. Corso told us they're not looking to go out and sign a lot of people, a lot of big names. They're going to try and build something, sign some free agents here and there.
They're going to have time now.
Oh, that ball was just thrown up for grabs. Smith was the closest man in a white jersey near the football. Jeff Smith, number 87. Also running over there was Wilford Morgan, 82, and that'll bring up a 4th down and bring on Greg Cater.
Wilford Morgan ran the wrong route. Smith's running over right now to tell his quarterback and his coach.
he was supposed to clear out, and he didn't get the corner back out of there, and it left the guy sitting right in front of Smith.
Knight standing at the 10. 2:51 left to go third quarter. Low spiraling kick, trying to angle it to the corner, but he got it in the end zone. So New Jersey will have it first and 10 from their own 20-yard line when we return to the Meadowlands at East Rutherford, New Jersey. O'clock start here tonight.
It's pretty early in this part of the country, 7 o'clock.
Yeah.
Usually they go at 9.
But at least everybody will get home early.
Yes.
At least some of us.
Some of us.
Flutie up to the 30 and close to a first down. Bernard West, 28, makes the tackle. And that was a designed running play
all the way
for Doug Flutie.
No pass receivers looking back over their shoulder. That was all Flutie on the run. 7 times for how many?
68 yards.
All right.
Well, Flutie's got 68. Walker's got 131. Carthen's got 27. And this is a team that's been averaging over 200 yards rushing, exactly 208 yards rushing per game. That, folks, is number one in the United States football league.
I would imagine. That's number one for a lot of teams.
This is Maurice Carthen. Carthen gets up to the 33. 59, Harold Randolph, a real good job that time. Also, Freeman, 56, was over there.
Those guys out there in the white jerseys got to be tired of seeing big backs running at them all night. Carthen must love it. For three quarters, or for 2.5 quarters, Herschel pounds on them, and then he gets to take over while they're all bruised and bumped.
You got the number one team against the rush, against the last place team against the rush.
Yes. And we're seeing it.
New Jersey, number one rushing in the league. Orlando last defending against him. Pass downfield and a bad pass that time. Bowers was the intended receiver. And West was on the coverage.
Flutie going to run down and talk to Bowers about something he wanted him to do. Give him his arm, maybe, so he can make a better throw. A little missed communication, I've got a feeling. Wanted him to turn back after he was rolling out.
Here's an interesting note. Flutie, 7 of 12 for 109 yards and a touchdown. Those were his exact statistics
last
week ago.
That sounded familiar.
New Jersey now on third down situations, 5 of 8. They've completed 54% on the year. Third down and 8 from the 32. Penalty markers down. Walker drops the football. And I want to tell you, right after he threw it, Flutie got racked by Kevin Kellen, 94.
Herschel Walker, as the pass receiver, I know exactly what he did here. He knew he was short of the first down, so he says, I got to run for
the
next
couple years. Fourth down.
Penalty was against New Jersey, declined, and that'll bring up a fourth down and 8. Kevin Kellen.
Nice to pick on 5'9 guys, right? Especially when you're that big. Everybody says he won't last, but he's been 5'9 all of his life, and people have been beating on him, and he's still here.
Second punt of the night for Partridge, and back deep is Victor Jackson.
All his football life, I should say, wasn't 5'9 when he was born. I'm sure people understood that, right?
I'm sure they did. I understood it perfectly.
Okay, thank
you. Of course,
you.
I have to work with you every week.
That's right.
Partridge from the 18. End over end kick. Jackson's going to be able to return this as he takes it at the 30. Jackson loses the football at the 39-yard line, so a 9-yard return for Victor Jackson as Ed Jackson makes the tackle. 38-yard on the punt. Generals 24, Renegades nothing.
Mint juleps.
Oh, that's a great time. First and 10 from the 40. 30 seconds left to go, third quarter. Mazolik makes the reception at the 45-yard line. Jerry Holmes is right there on him. And Mazolik, who came into the game with 18 receptions, has already 8 on the evening.
Big night for Mazolik. 6'5", 250, and can run a little bit. That's what you want a tight end. And can catch the football. 7.
Make it 7 receptions for 71 yards. Left elbow of Doug Flutie being iced down. And that's the end of the third quarter, folks, from the Meadowlands in East Rutherford, New Jersey. We've got 15 minutes left to go in this game between the Generals and the Renegades, and New Jersey leads Orlando 24-0. Roger Twible, Mike Hafter with you. Thanks for being with us on this Monday night. Generals 24-0 over the Orlando Renegades. Gades with the ball, second and six, and Collier with the long pass. Jackie Flowers, the intended receiver. They slipped in a play on me before the end of the third quarter. Reggie Collier, his third year from Southern Mississippi. A lot of people in NFL want to make him a wide receiver or something like that, and he said, I'm going to go play quarterback.
A lot of guys do that. Go up to Canada, find themselves some place to play quarterback. Saw Collier on the roll. He throws better on the run, I believe, as a youngster now. As he matures, he'll be able to sit back in the pocket and throw it.
Four wideouts, third and six from the 44-yard line. Orlando looking here. They have not been shut out yet this year. Collier going deep. He's got Walters wide open. Penalty marker is down. Some bumping on the near side between Holmes and Flowers. And Holmes has been getting into it with a number of wide receivers. And it looks like it's going to go against the New Jersey Generals.
Jerry Holmes, illegal chuck, automatic first down. Keeps the drive alive
holding
for the Gates.
Number 37 on the defense. The first down.
Well, they call it holding. Same thing. Both would have given the first down. Take a few more chances when you're at 24-0.
Herschel Walker, another big, big night for the Heisman Trophy winner from Georgia. Natural strength. As a kid, used to do push-ups, sit-ups. Never has really done much weight work.
Boy, and you wouldn't know it by looking at that neck and those shoulders, would you?
I'll tell you, natural strength, I think, in the long run is the best.
Oh, yeah. Time. Don't pull hamstrings or muscles then.
Collier has to get rid of it because he is nailed. Mattias came in and really put a hit on Reggie Collier, and he just tried to get rid of it and get it out of bounds.
Say, not only do you need great athletic ability to throw the ball and run it well, but also to avoid injury. I'll tell you what, a lot of quarterbacks would have had their ribs caved in there, but he made a little quick move, got himself down on the ground before he really got drilled.
So look at Mattias, second year from Holy Cross. Second and 10, the 49-yard line of Orlando. Just underway, fourth quarter. They're bringing everybody, and Collier can't go anywhere. Bobby Leopold, the veteran from Notre Dame, sends him down, and of course, you understand that everybody in the world knows that Reggie Collier's throwing the football right
now.
Oh,
yeah. I'll tell you what, Bobby Leopold got a little break here. The ground helped sack him. Half the sack goes to the artificial surface. The other half goes to Leopold. He was stumbling all the way back from center. 14-yard loss.
Yeah. Well, it's been that kind of night.
Oh, yeah.
For the Orlando Renegades. Well, they hung tough. Just 10-0 at halftime. Had a chance to get some points before the half. Couldn't do it.
That turned the game.
They're faced with a third and 20. Collier hit. It's going to be intercepted. Gregory Johnson, his second interception of the year, and a penalty marker goes down at the 44-yard line. Collier is still down on the ground.
I don't think he's hurt. I think he's just dejected. Well, let's hope so, anyway. Not moving.
And a personal foul has been called on the tackle upfield after the interception.
Take a look and see where he got drilled. I know who
Freddie
it was.
Gilbert.
90. Freddie Gilbert is the one that got him. Oh! And here's the result. Of course, his arm was hit. He was trying to hit Walters over the middle, and when he was hit, popped up in the air.
And Gregory
Johnson. The interception. Johnson.
Fifth year from Oklahoma State.
Collier's still down. Well, we see Johnson go down.
And if Collier can't return, that means Jerry Goldstein. .1342 left to go in the game, and we'll be back to the Meadowlands in just a little bit of help as Generals put it in play. First and 10 from the 40-yard line. Maurice Carthen over the left side. Picks up about three. Flutie's all right. He had a little ice on his left elbow, but he said no problem. But Reggie Collier getting some ice applied to the small of his back. And Jerry Goldstein, who toiled for the New York Giants at one time, coming to this ballpark, is warming up on the sidelines.
The Zonka years, he was here with the Giants.
And look at this formation. Two players split to the near side.
Razzle dazzle.
Flutie sends it to Carthen, who drops the football. And they call it an incomplete pass. Now,
can't advance it. It was a forward pass.
Yeah, but I want to know, 24 to nothing, what they're doing.
I'd like to know, too. You know what they're doing? They're showing something that the other team's going to have to work on next week.
Okay.
All right?
I'll take that as a
will you take that?
I don't think Orlando will understand it that way.
I don't think so either. Running up the score. Here, we'll take a look. You know, he's got two options. If he feels the screen pass will go, he'll throw it here. If they all run over there with him, Flutie will run the other way. Now, come on, Carthen. You're supposed to catch that.
They used that once before this year in a game against the Express. Third down and eight from the 38-yard line. Carthen in the slot. Intercepted.
Uh-oh.
Intercepted by Jeff George, and he can go all the way. Flutie can maybe catch him. He caught up with him. George is still on his feet. Now Flutie gets him back at the 8-yard line, and he took the football away.
Well, he's done everything tonight.
We're going to say it's Orlando football.
What you don't do with a rookie quarterback is to throw a set pattern where it's a timing pattern, because if he can't read the defense, you're going to get it picked off, and that's exactly what he did. 57-yard return. See, they had a little combination pass, but Orlando threw zone at him, rolled it up against it, and Flutie threw right into it. Gets picked off and 57 yards down the field after two shots. There's one. Flutie gets back up, makes a tackle.
Fourth interception for Jeff George.
For
remember,
Jeff
he
George.
Almost had one earlier this evening. So,
I like Flutie's extra effort. Missed him the first time, got back up off the ground, and got him down at the 13-yard line.
16, Fred Hessen, one of the backup quarterbacks, saying, "Hey, Doug, I'll go in anytime you want to come out."
You think they'll let him in the defensive back meeting this week for making the play?
Well, you know, there was some talk that if he would have been available for the NFL draft, that people were projecting maybe as a punt returner,
free safety.
Safety, wide receiver.
I don't know if he would have been a good enough tackler playing the secondary. Pretty much would have had to play him, I think, at quarterback no matter where.
We've got a holdup on the field, and it appears as though we might have had a red flag drop. Now,
I didn't
see the red flag.
I didn't
drop.
See it either.
Referee Bill Parkinson. We got a few fans who are jumping onto the field causing some problems, so well, apparently there was a red flag dropped, and
whether
Flutie
maybe did he get the fumble at the end? Remember, he was jumping up and down at the end.
It looked as though he'd taken the ball away, so maybe Michaels was saying, why not? I'll give it a shot and
sure.
See you.
You're up 24-0. Let's see if I can get a red flag. Yeah?
Anyway, that's what happened because it cost him a timeout.
Yep, and it wasn't a fumble either.
So the Orlando Renegades, who have not been shut out this year, have Reggie Collier on the bench, and Jerry Goldstein will be the quarterback. Collier with a back injury and more than likely will not return this evening. We've got 12:25 left to go. Walters and Flowers split to the near side. Goldstein's first pass, touchdown. Jackie Flowers. And penalty marker is down in the end zone.
I believe that Joey Walters picked. And you know what that is? It's
catching
a screen play.
On the offense, number 17.
Oh, yeah.
Walters down.
And Walters is livid. He's going into the end zone.
That's who they call. Just like a plus screen play when you're getting your buddy a jump shot.
And that's what they called him for. He snuck in the end zone, picked off the guy who was supposed to be covering the receiver, and that cost him.
They'll move it back to the 18. I'll tell you, Walters earlier this evening got into it with Holmes.
Yes.
Decided to jump offside and give Holmes a quick slap to the head.
Ah, the old veterans get frustrated.
Now the four wideouts again. 82 Wilfred Morgan is split to the near side with Walters. On second and 18, Golston. Got Walters, touchdown!
Great catch. Great concentration to keep his feet in.
Well, that's right back in your face, isn't it?
Yep.
Oh, Jerry Goldstein, two touchdown passes on two plays, right?
On two plays. One didn't count. Lots of great concentration by number 17, Walter. No pressure on Goldstein. He gets the time to throw it. See him adjust, keep those feet in. What a great catch.
Fourth touchdown pass of the year for Jerry Goldstein. Fourth-year man from Northern Illinois, and Walters with five receptions for 89 yards. And with 11:53 to go, 24-6. Rockhouse to attempt the point after. And he's got it. So, the Orlando Renegades on the scoreboard. There's a look at the quarterback who came in and got him 7 points in a hurry. 24-7, New Jersey. We'll return to the Meadowlands in East Rutherford, New Jersey in just a moment. Joey Walters, ninth year from Clemson, and his first touchdown reception of the season after catching some 28 passes this year. Drive kickoff taken by Danny Knight.
And the kicking team.
That was an offsides on the kicking team. That was Rod Pegues who brought that kickoff back.
Another look at the touchdown pass. Goldston with lots of time. Here's the veteran, Joey Walters. Slows down, drags the lead foot. He's in. Touchdown.
And the penalty was declined by New Jersey, so with 11:45 left to go, at a 24-7 lead, Doug Flutie will bring his team back and
look out.
Maybe a little ball control offense right now.
Herschel Carthen Show. I've renamed it the running backs.
Marcus Anderson has checked in at wide receiver. He is the lone wideout at the top of your screen.
Two tight ends, two backs, run the clock.
Herschel left. Just about got it to the outside. Harold Randolph, 59, able to knock him out of bounds, but another good gain of nearly 8 yards. Mike, Herschel's been going to the left a lot in this game.
Other teams get films of your tendencies. He's run to the right, especially over his favorite offensive linemen, Harris and Maggs, with some help from Center Hall. And I'm certain that Lou said, hey, wait a minute. I'm sure they've scouted us. Our tendency is to run right. Let's run Herschel left this time and see if they've overcompensated. Obviously, they have. He's gained a bunch.
Second and three. Herschel up the middle. He's got the first down.
All right,
up to near the 45-yard line. Albert Gray, the right corner, came up to make the tackle. Now, the man up front, Ken Hull, 58 to center, has not missed a game in the history of the New Jersey Generals. And the man playing next to him, Wayne Harris, was his teammate at Mississippi State. So the center and the right guard, they've been playing together an awful long time. Maybe a lot of folks won't think that means too much, but offensive linemen, it means a heck of a lot.
Yes, there is. There's that special ESP you have between each other. You don't have to say anything. You kind of know all your own tendencies. And it really helps out on the combination blocks.
First and 10. Going deep to Danny Knight. Pass was overthrown. Albert Gray was back on the coverage.
A play action pass there, huh? They haven't given up scoring. They're mad because they couldn't get the shutout. So they're going to make it 31-7.
Yeah, you just wonder, as you look at Doug Flutie, what that one play, which we've seen a million times, if that hadn't happened. I mean, he was still a great quarterback and such, but that one play, I happen to be standing in the corner of the Orange Bowl.
Yeah, made him a couple million, didn't it?
when he let fly with that thing.
Gerald Phelan, I don't even think thought he'd get there. Gerard Phelan.
Gerard made a heck of a catch, too.
Oh, yeah.
On second and 10, Herschel's got it. Doesn't have much room. Penalty marker goes down.
Screenplay setup could be an illegal lineman downfield.
I want to say Vince Strauss, 66.
Tried to sneak back, didn't he? Did you see him?
Receiver, number 58, downfield. It's a loss of down.
I saw him trying to sneak back, Roger. He's trying to sneak back, and the guy's shaking his finger going, I caught you. Screen passes are all timing. And
there's a look at Hall, 58, 6'4", 266. And that is Ed Jackson of the Generals who...
Orlando.
Ankle injury and been some hard hitting in this game tonight, especially by the Orlando defense trying to bring down Herschel Walker. And there goes Herschel again, still on his feet. Across the 45, up to the 48-yard line.
Herschel on the inside running play. A little bit of trap blocking. Look at him pick his way. He's never, not anywhere near full speed. And he's either going to make you pay the price by lowering his shoulder. Take a look at 64. Turns him outside.
Wayne Harris.
Yep.
Fourth down punt by Partridge. Fair catch being called by Victor Jackson. And he hauls it in at the 14-yard line. So 9:16 left to go. 24-7. The Generals lead it. Friday at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific time. Mike Kelly did a good job getting the start against Denver, leading the Showboats to a win. And Birmingham.
Going to be mad this week.
Reggie Collier. Well, the back's bad, but he says he's all right. Yeah, he's all right.
Happy birthday to who?
I didn't catch it.
I didn't either.
You can ask him afterwards. Goldstein. Walters got it at the 35. So Joey Walters has been a busy man tonight for the Orlando Renegades.
I asked before the game where he's been. He answered. He's here. Had over 100 catches in Canada in 1 year. Great receiver. It kind of disappeared when he came down to the Federals, and now with the Renegades.
Not been a real prosperous franchise. Were they 9 victories in 3 years, something like that? First and 10, ball at the 35, 4 wide receivers in the game. Golson's going deep. On the far side, Jerry Parrish was in a foot race with Ken Johnson.
Good throw on first down. Loosens up the defensive backs. Next time around, when you run the crossing pattern to your tight ends or your inside slot backs, you'll have a lot more room to throw it.
Renegades have all of their timeouts remaining. 8:17 left to go in this game.
Generals lost one of theirs on the red flag. Kind of a waste, I think, by Michaels.
Flowers and Smith come to the near side. Walters and Perry split to the far side on a second and 10. Walters, the intended receiver. Danelle Daniel is defending, and a penalty marker down as Golston gets up. Curtin.
Yeah, he got rough.
Yeah. Though. Jim Byrne hit him a bit late.
Golston also made a misread. He threw it into the zone defense. He should have come to the other side, but it'll all come out in the wash here. Pain for the 15 yards instead of the completion.
Lee Corso is just a bit animated on the sidelines, isn't he?
Let's take a reason why we get the penalty flag.
And they're going to win.
Ball's gone. He's looking and then gets drilled right in the stomach.
They're warming Pizarkowitz up because they feel
he took a shot.
Yeah. That Golston might not have the cobwebs clear yet. First and 10 right from midfield. Nizolik to the 44-yard line with 8 receptions. As as the clock continues to run with 7:34 left to go. Mazzolik, 8 catches for 76 yards. Walters, 6 for 111.
Might be both of their best nights, and they're getting beat 24-7.
Mm-hmm.
Shows you how important Herschel Walker is. Got to have the running game to go with the passing game.
Walters comes to the near side with Jerry Parrish. Smith and Flowers split to the far side. On 2nd and 4, and there was a bit of a mix-up right there as Jerry Parrish did a, what about, 10-yard turn in.
Yeah. Yeah, he did a little comeback, 15-10, and Golson thought he was going on a streak. Miscommunications, I've got a feeling. Of course, the last time that happened, Gregory Johnson got an interception.
Unfortunately, Jerry threw that one far enough that nobody was going to track it down. Third down now, 4 yards to go. Less than 7 minutes left in this game. A win would move New Jersey into a tie for first place in the Eastern Conference. Orlando looking for respectability. Tip, tip, tipped again. Nobody can come up with it. John Miller was there for New Jersey. Bobby Leopold was there. And also Ken Johnson.
I can hear the linebacker coach now saying, hey, we practiced this all week. Come on, guys. Got two tips here. Throw the floater receiver, over the middle. Receiver
two,
tip. There's another one.
Three.
Three. Oops. Slipped right through his hand.
Fourth down now for the Renegades. 4 yards to go.
No, there's a penalty on the play. Holding defense.
Defensive holding. And that'll make it a first down. 10 yards to go.
I think they held Mazzolik when he was trying to come across the middle, and that's what they called. Before the tip drill started
tonight.
Yeah, I know we have. That one snuck in on us, didn't it?
Walters off his shoulders. Jerry Holmes was a man defending.
If you're a defensive back and you're covering on the deep route, if you turn around to look, you're going to lose two steps. So watch him. All he does is watch his eyes. You see it perfectly here. He knows when the ball's coming because he turns his head back and his eyes get a little bit bigger and he reaches a hand up. And I think it went off his hand rather than off Walter's shoulder.
Second down and 10.
That's veteran defensive backs play.
Wilford Morgan will come in and Walters will come out of the game. He's been getting a workout tonight.
Oh, yeah.
6:23 left to go in the game as Parrish goes in motion to the far side. Very, very good defensive play by Jerry Holmes. I'll tell you what, if you're a cornerback, and I don't care whether you're USFL, NFL, CFL, yep, you got to be cocky, don't you?
Oh, yes. It's lonely out there. I'll tell you what, you saw the perfect coverage on the outside and the deep route. Now here's the one on the outside. And did you notice a little hand hooked on the backside?
The right hand underneath?
Yeah, that's a veteran defensive back's play. He knows where the back judge is. He knows what he can get away with.
Third down and 10. Orlando 5 of 11 now. Third down conversions. Golston, look out. Well, he really decided to eat at that time. But Bobby Leopold was in there. Also James Lockett, who leads the Generals in sacks.
Golston to the well once too often. Waiting for a receiver to break open. Now he's going to break outside trying to buy some time. And Golston is not Reggie Collier. He hasn't got those quick feet and hasn't got the kind of speed to be doing that.
Cater will come in on a 4th and 21. Standing back at his 34-yard line, Generals with 3 sacks for 28 yards. Knight's going to let it go. Now he takes it. To the 15-yard line. That's a dangerous play right there.
Now you're going to talk him to for that, even though he's ahead 24-7.
Winding down in this game, 5:45 left to go on a rather historic day in the United States Football League as the decision was made 12-2 to go to the fall of 86, so spring football as we know it right now is history, although John Bassett says that he's going to stay in the spring. He's got one team.
43 teams, including London, Mexico City, and Paris.
Maurice Carthen, still on his feet. Across the 20 to the 21. Now, what was that about Mexico City and Paris and London?
Well, that's what Mr. Bassett says. Well, I got 43 cities, including Mexico City, Paris, London. I'll believe it when I see it.
Yeah.
The airlines would love it, wouldn't they? You asked me while we were away why Flutie still in the game. They paid their money to see Mr. Flutie, the superstar of Boston College, and if they took him out, I'm afraid they'd boo him here.
Well, he hasn't done much in his last seven passing attempts. On the night, 7 of 17, 109 yards, a TD and an interception, so 11 touchdowns, 11 interceptions on the year. Second down and three from the 22-yard line.
Pegues,
who is out of Oklahoma, spent some time in Denver with the Broncos. Rod Pegues, 6'1", 209.
Flutie's still in, but Herschel isn't.
And rightly so, Herschel, 141 yards this evening.
There's the right side of that line now that Herschel's out and they've got the tendencies out of the way. They go back to those fine right side of the offensive line. Bowers makes a good block, 89. Carthen with the lead block.
First and 10 at the 28-yard line. 4 minutes left to go in this football game. 24-7, the Generals lead. The Renegades, their first meeting this year, a 28-10 win when Flutie threw four touchdown passes.
Last 5 weeks, Roger, that's Herschel's just had awesome games. For the last 5 weeks, this offensive line for the Generals has been the exact same five guys, and that's made a difference, too.
Walt Michaels, who told us yesterday when we asked him about Flutie, the one thing that's really impressed him coming in at a late date to camp and trying to learn the offense was when he could get outside, how he could see downfield, his vision, as Steve Pizarkiewicz is warming up on the sidelines. Golston, we understand, has a broken left hand and will not return. So the third quarterback.
He's carrying stuff by Tynes.
Pizarkiewicz.
Clock running. 2:49 left to go. There is Jerry Golston. Came in through a touchdown pass, broken left hand. We saw it on that hit on the personal foul against Byrne.
Tried to continue to go. Tough to take snaps. You still throw the football, but taking the snap, you're going to fumble it every time with that kind of pain. Boy, if Collier can't play next week, the Renegades are in trouble at quarterback.
Third down and six. Flutie will go the other way.
The Wizard of West Jersey.
He's like a little water bug out there.
Yeah, he is.
Flutie, stopped by Kellen.
Kaptur never played quarterback.
Yeah, I did.
Did you?
Yeah, they tried anyway. I played tailback in the single wing. And this looked like me. Except I didn't have that kind of speed. Look at this.
I got to tell you, if you're an offensive lineman, you got to like him, but you probably hate him a little bit too, don't you? It's kind of a love-hate relationship with Flutie.
Yeah, you can be running around blocking four or five times for that young man. He did the smart thing. He got down so nobody broke his left hand.
Timeout on the field by Orlando with 2:09 left to go in the game. Victor Jackson at the 28. 2 minutes left to go. The Generals lead the Renegades 24-7. And Orlando will have it first and 10 when we return. Minutes left to go, or to be exact, 1:58, if you will. New Jersey a 24-7 lead, and we're going to take a look at new quarterback, third one of the night for the Orlando Renegades from the University of Missouri, formerly a top pick by the St. Louis Cardinals.
Number one,
Steve Pizarkiewicz.
Then they found out that he had 2,400 vision when he came to training camp. Correctable. But, oh, it's tough for quarterbacks.
Four wideouts. To Zarkowitz, going to Wilfred Morgan, and a penalty marker, and that's going to be interference.
Got a flag,
Terry Daniels, not to be confused with Donnell Daniel, was the guilty party, so the Renegades will get it.
First down.
In a little bit better field position. They had a first down.
Pretty tough call right here. Although I understand why they called the pass interference. Right arm in front of him. But every defensive backfield coach will argue with you that he has as much right to the path to the ball as the receiver. Yeah, he shielded him a little bit. Yeah, I like the guys in the striped shirts. They got the better angle than we do.
He's thought about becoming an official, haven't you?
Boy, they get big money, don't they?
They don't pay them enough, that's for sure. Interception. Donnell Daniel. Off the shoulder pad of Wilfred Morgan.
You know why we talk about the tip drill? Because it's so difficult to get from a defensive posture when you're going in to break up a pass or make a tackle, and then change to an offensive player when the ball pops up in the air. Watch what a great job Donnell Daniel does. Well, first of all, let's see if Zarkowitz
going. Frank Mattier's got a pretty good lick in.
But see how much, he's coming in to make the tackle. Now he's got to adjust to be a pass receiver. And a great job by Daniel, 23.
And checking in for the Generals, Ron Reeves, quarterback, huh?
With 143 to go, you can take your million-dollar man out.
Third-year man from Texas Tech, 143 left to go. Do get some practice handing the ball off. Maurice Carthen.
Think the Gates will call timeout? If they do, I'm going to run down there and punch the Corso.
They don't want to get it back again anyway, do they?
There you go. They're out of quarterbacks.
My mom and dad and my frat brother. 38.
Nice to be a winner, huh? How come they always say hi, Mom? They never say hi, Dad.
No, he said hi, Mom and Dad and my frat
brothers. Oh, good, good.
He got everybody
in. He got everybody in, all right. But it's always Mom first, though. She gets you to practice. Dad always says, who won?
Reeves is going to carry it. By mistake, but he's going to carry it.
Hey,
still going.
Get a little Flutie here.
Yeah, he's been hanging around Flutie a long time, huh? Inside the 40.
Rubs
inside
up.
The 35 to the 34-yard line is Ron Reeves.
Well, I said Flutie was the Wizard of West Jersey. What do we make Reeves here?
Well, he's from West Texas.
Okay, the Wizard of West Texas.
18 yards on the pickup.
His own lineman knocked him down.
Speaking of Texas, we're going to be in Oregon next Monday night.
How do we get
Gamblers?
Oh, Houston Gamblers. There we go.
Get to see Jim Kelly and company.
Now, Kelly had another day at the office over the weekend, huh? Four touchdown passes.
And they'll just let the clock run out.
That's the end of it.
Yeah. Herschel.
Yeah, and Flutie,
might have
too.
Flutie didn't have a great, great game. Flutie, 8 rushes, 67 yards, 7 of 17, 109 in the TD. Not bad, but Herschel was the guy that really made it happen.
It was over when they didn't score at the end of the half. That made the difference.
Yeah, absolutely right. 24-7 the final. And we'll return to the Meadowlands in East Rutherford right after this. Final score, New Jersey 24, Orlando 7, as the Generals move into a three-way tie for first place in the Eastern Conference. And USFL action continues next week on ESPN with three live games. Friday, May 3rd at 8 Eastern, Birmingham takes on Memphis live here on ESPN. And then Saturday, May 4th at 8 Eastern, Tampa Bay against Los Angeles live. And then next Monday night, May 6th at 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific time, the Houston Gamblers take on Portland. That'll be live from Portland, Oregon. Big night for Herschel Walker, 22 carries, 158 yards. Doug Flutie also with an outstanding effort. Final score once again, 24-7. For Mike Hafner, this is Roger Twaddle saying goodnight, everybody, from the Meadowlands in East Rutherford, New Jersey.